Hi everyone, I'm Mark with Manhattan Prep, and we're going to take a look today at an intermediate level GMAT problem. I'm going to give you some time to work on this on your own. You can pause the video and try it out. But before you do that, let me encourage you to do a couple things maybe differently from the way you're approaching problems right now. The number one process mistake I see students make is jumping too quickly into the things that really should come at the end of the problem, the actual calculations. GMAT problems are designed so that a lot of the heavy lift is actually in the upfront work. So let's break up some of those bad habits from high school and junior high math by putting our pens down, taking a deep breath to reset, and just taking a glance at this thing. What I notice right away is that this is a problem-solving problem. So I want my eyes to go not to the text of the problem, but to the answer choices. Give those some consideration for a few seconds. What do they tell you about the kind of problem you're about to solve? Then you can start reading the problem, but one last thing, keep that pen down until you actually have a good sense of what you want to write. Pause the video, give yourself 2 minutes, try this out. Okay, let's take a look at this thing together. So what did you notice about the answer choices when you glanced? I'll point out a couple things that I see. These are all fractions. I really get a sense of the content that's going to be tested. And I see that they range from a pretty large fraction, close to one in choice A, 25 29ths, all the way down to a relatively small fraction in choice E. In particular, these are split out around the fraction 1/2. That could be interesting. If I got stumped on this problem and I've got to bail, I can just answer the simpler version of this question. Should the fraction they want be more or less than 1/2? Take a decent guess and move on. So let's take a look at this problem. A popular yoga studio. I love the details on these things. They want you to know this place is popular. That's why it's filled to capacity, I suppose. In fact, they're going to need to move to a new studio. This is when I pick up my pen, because I know I'm going to get things mixed up between the two studios if I don't create some sort of chart to track this. So what have I got? A couple different yoga studios, YS. I've got an old one, and I've got a new one. Just making a little table here with these column headers. And I've got different types of students to track as well. I've got old students. I've got new students. And I want to keep track of the total as well, total capacity for both the old and the new studio. So we have gotten to the end of the problem, seen all of the kind of information there. We're gonna need to go back and extract some of it to actually solve. What did they never give us here though? They're talking about a number of students and a percent change, but they never told us an actual value for the number of students. That can only mean that the actual value does not matter. And I'm free to just make up my own value. This is called picking a smart number. And that's what I'm gonna do. Right here into the old number of students at the old studio, I'm gonna plug 100. Of course, there were no new students there. That is the total capacity of the old studio. Now, when I go to the new studio, it's gonna increase by 45%. So there's the new capacity here, 145. What kind of students are gonna be attending the new studio? Well, 20% of the old students can't come to the new studio. So we're down to just 80 of them, and yet we're still at capacity. So the other 65 must be the new students. Final thing, let's make sure we're actually answering the right question at the end of this. I've got the fraction of the students at the new location who will be new students. So I can just pull those numbers from my chart. 65 of them are new out of 145 students at the new studio. In essence, that's my answer. Now, it doesn't show up in the choices because the fraction has been reduced. So this is an important moment in the problem as well. If the GMAT were the kind of test that allowed you to have a calculator, I'm done with this video. There's nothing else to say here. Pop that into your calculator, you'll have your answer. But the GMAT is not that kind of test. And it's so important to develop some good computation habits. I mentioned earlier that we don't want to dive into these computations. Well, even when we get to the final couple steps, we still want to be intentional here. And I'll point out a couple things you can keep in mind to improve your computational efficiency and computational accuracy. First and foremost, ask yourself what computations you actually need to do. Do I need to do this here? Look at it, 65 over 145. So that is going to be just a touch less than 1/2. Half of 140 would have been 70. So I know right away that these choices A, B, and C that are all more than a half can't possibly be right. Well, what do I have left here between D and E? Again, I've got a fraction in D that's less than a half, but pretty close, and a fraction in E that's just way too small. 65 over 145, that's definitely more than a third, which is approximately what E is. So I don't need to do any of this computation. I can use reasoning to get down to the right answer. And suppose this were a different problem where, say, choices D and E were a little closer together. You couldn't quite eyeball it in this way. First off, only do computations you need to do. And my second big tip here is don't do one hard computation when you can do multiple easy ones instead. I can tell that one thing I could do here is cancel out a 5, because both the top and the bottom of the fraction are divisible by 5. But I don't know 65 over 5 or 145 over 5 right off the top of my head. So I'm going to look to trade out that harder computation for multiple easy ones. Here's a nice little technique I can use. What if I actually double both the top and the bottom? Well, now I'm at 130 on top and 290 in the denominator, and check it out. Zeros are canceled and D is our answer here. So rather than dividing by 5 once, that one hard computation, I multiplied by 2, which was pretty easy, and divided by 10, which was also pretty easy. And I actually get to the answer faster doing those two easy steps than I would doing the one hard one. Take a moment and reflect on this. What do you want to take away from this problem? You'll undoubtedly have your own takeaways, but let me point out a couple that I want you to keep in mind. One, you are training for something. You're not just studying for a test. You are training the habits now that you want to have on test day. So think very intentionally about this every time you sit down to do a problem. Secondly, let's consider our options before we dive into one particular approach. I have so many students who would just default to setting up algebra here, and they're doing so much more work than they need to. If they had invested a little extra time up front to figure out that we could just plug in a smart number, they would have actually saved time on the back end because they've got an easier approach. And finally, think about those computational techniques we mentioned. It is really important on the GMAT because to get to those expert level problems, and we'll do some videos on those coming up, we've got to be perfect on the foundational stuff and perfect on the intermediate problems like this. Subscribe for more GMAT Math Spotlight videos from Manhattan Prep and leave us a comment telling us how you solved this problem. Happy studying.